Good afternoon and welcome to Berks Community Health Center Presents. I'm Mary Ellen Maher-Harkins. I'm the Director of Communications at Berks Community Health Center. And with me today is Dr. Umer, Ambreen Umer.
Yes.
Dr. Hi. Umer is a infectious disease specialist at the Reading Hospital, works at the Center for Public Health and also other functions in the hospital. And Dr. Mary Kelleher, who is our Chief Medical Officer at Berks Community Health Center. Welcome to both of you. Thank you for being here. Today we're going to be talking about HIV infection, which used to mean AIDS to people, but probably doesn't necessarily mean that anymore. It's a real important topic to think about for the new year. We're going to dive right into it. HIV is, correct me if I'm wrong, human immunodeficiency
syndrome,
or virus.
The virus, right.
Human and HIV infection. Dr. Umer, what does that mean for people nowadays?
AIDS have evolved a lot over years. As you know, it used to be like a death sentence many years ago. There were a lot of taboo associated with it. People were reluctant to get tested, and they were often tested very late. So now with better testing, we have a lot of patients who are diagnosed very early in the disease stage, and there are a lot more better options now for treatment. So people are living a long, healthy life. Most of the time, we're seeing patients with other medical problems like primary care issues, diabetes, high blood pressure. So AIDS in most of our population is very well controlled if they're doing their part, if they're taking their medications, following our instructions, being compliant. It's a totally different disease now.
Yeah, because when we first became aware of AIDS, which was early or middle 1980s, mm-hmm. I guess, AIDS was only AIDS. If you had HIV, you got AIDS. Is that true anymore? Does everyone who has an HIV infection get AIDS or develop AIDS?
It's the same virus. The differentiation is based on the how good their immune deficiency is, like how bad it is. So it's a number that you have to look up. And the cutoff of the number, less than 200 is AIDS, if a CD4 count, more than 200 is HIV. So it's the same virus, it's just defined differently for medical terms, and that just tells you where in the disease spectrum you are.
So there are people, I guess, who just would never be diagnosed as actually having AIDS, which was acquired immune deficiency syndrome, right?
Yeah.
So people can live with HIV as an infection and get treatment for it in today's world.
Yes. Most people would not progress to AIDS if they're diagnosed early, if they're picked up, if they're doing well.
That's kind of amazing. Dr. Kelleher, in primary care practice, and I should mention now, because if you're watching the show live today on Friday, January 6th, at Berks Community Health Center today, from until 3:30 this afternoon, there is free rapid HIV testing. So we know if people are watching while the show is live, it is completely free. It's being offered in collaboration with Coe County Wellness. It's a rapid HIV test, and we're going to talk a little bit about why people should be tested and know their status, but that event is going on today, January 6th until 3:30. So if you're near 838 Penn Street and you want to stop in, it takes about half an hour, and that's something you could get today to know your status. Let's talk about that for a second. Dr. Kelleher, why should people know their HIV status?
I think the most important thing that we've also just stressed today is that there are treatment available. And it used to be, and I remember kind of being overwhelmed as a family doc about the treatment with HIV, that it was so complicated, so many pills, and not just treatment available, but simplified treatments and easy treatments, because the key is when patients have the diagnosis, they can be treated, and if compliant with the diagnosis, they can do very well. In fact, the fact that you bring up diabetes and hypertension is an incredible statement, because they may be at more risk of dying from their diabetes and their hypertension than from the actual HIV, which is a big switch from how it used to be. So you can't do anything about something you don't know. And so, you know, people estimate that maybe 1 in 8 people don't know their HIV status. And so there's a lot of people who could benefit from staying healthy and getting treatment if they only knew that they were positive.
Do you think in folks that you see coming in for treatment, at what point are people coming to you at the Center for Public Health for treatment? Are there people who are being diagnosed earlier and coming and being treated effectively? Or are there still people who are coming in who really had no idea and who've developed the syndrome?
Most of our patients are tested at outpatient, and they are tested because of some injury or some kind of health factors that prompted the testing as an outpatient. Mm. So they already tested, and they tested positive, and they referred to us at Center of Public Health. We do see some patients in the hospital who are admitted with serious infections, and during that hospitalization, they were tested and they turned back positive. They're often the more sicker patients. So they are towards the AIDS definition most of the time. Mm-hmm. We also see some of the partners who are tested, and frequently they get positive, and they are tested in our facility, and then they become and establish as our patients.
When AIDS was first, HIV infection and AIDS were first discovered, if that's the right way to put it, it was really perceived as only being a part of, or the people who were most likely at risk were the gay community, mostly men, and that was the high risk. And then after that, I guess people who were IV drug users. Has that changed over time and more? How is the infection spreading now?
In our county, heterosexual is the most common group, which is surprising.
Really?
We do see a lot of men who have sex with men, and drug users as a significant other risk factors. But in our community, heterosexual patients are the most common. And normally they are in 40s to 60s age group, most of them. Yeah.
So do you think, is it just a question of people not being conscious anymore that this is a possibility because it's not in the public eye so much?
I think a lot of patients don't think about it. Sometimes they have had unprotected encounters, and sometimes they're college kids, and they're also business people, so travelers. So sometimes people have had quite a long time ago, and they're picked up as outpatient by the primary care due to some lab abnormality. They mm-hmm. might not have a manifestation of AIDS or any of the symptoms of AIDS for a very long time. So once a person acquires HIV virus, they can be asymptomatic for a very long time and not know they have it. And they can go and infect other people.
Even right? decades.
Right, and I think one of the most important things about that is why it's recommended for everybody to get tested, because even when I talk to some of my adolescents or some of my young adults, people think, oh, I would know if they have HIV, or they're dirty, or they do drugs, or, you know, but the fact that heterosexual transmission is so high in Berks County is saying that people are having high-risk sexual encounters and don't even realize they're high-risk sexual encounters. So, you know, the main thing is that you don't know who's positive, you don't know, you know, who is carrying the disease, and so it's really important for everybody to be tested. And that comes as a surprise because people don't see themselves at risk. But really, the recommendations are everybody age 13, which takes people a little bit back, to age 64, get at least one lifetime HIV testing.
And all pregnant patients. All pregnant patients.
Is that mandatory?
Yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense. Because can it be transferred from the mother to the baby?
Yes. We don't see that much nowadays because we're very good at, you know, preventive medicine and getting the patients right in the system, getting good OBGYN care during intrapartum care. So. Mm-hmm.
So if the mom is HIV positive and gets tested and she knows, then she's able to be treated so she doesn't spread the infection
to her child. Yes,
that's
we do
great.
Have.
What are the barriers people feel when you're in the primary care office and you're talking with every one of your patients about getting tested for HIV? What do people worry about? How can you help people overcome the fear they have of getting tested?
I think you answered it in the question because you said the fear. So a lot of times people, we just had a patient today who was talking about the HIV test. I don't know if I want to get tested. I don't know if I want to know. And we have to give them some, yes, you do want to know because you can do something about it. So I think it's a fear. I think it's also a lack of an assessment to feel that they're at risk. So they think it's something that other people can get. So I think it's sometimes a fear of finding out, then what's the stigma that's going to come with that? Am my family going to judge me? Am I not going to be able to hug my grandchildren hello? And then the second part is, you know, I'm not at risk. So that's for someone else to worry about, but not at me. And we want to kind of knock down that barrier and that way of thinking to get more people tested.
So I guess we should talk about some of those myths in terms of, can I hug my grandchildren? Do people who are HIV infected, do they have to cut off contact, physical contact with their families? Are they endangering their family just by normal day-to-day living?
Actually, most of our patients have told their families, and most of the family is very accepting because the perception of the disease has changed a lot. Mm-hmm. It's recommended for them to have some kind of support system. It's a good idea. There is no special barriers that you can live a normal life. The only time you are at risk is blood, you know, transfusions or obviously any kind of contact with blood products. Mm-hmm. So, and sexual, of course.
Yeah.
So, you know, if they are careful, if they didn't have any injury, just normal day-to-day lifestyle is not a problem.
So you can kiss your grandchildren.
Yep.
It's not saliva. I know when I was younger, it was the idea that if someone kissed you and they had HIV, that you could be infected, and that's not true.
You have to have broken skin, you know, for contact. So any kind of patient who are like. If a patient bit you or something, then that would be, but normally you would not experience. We do that once in a while too.
Yeah.
So any kind of exposure, you know, but normal touching, talking, you know, just being in there, it's not spread by air.
Mm-hmm.
So it's nothing to worry about.
So when people have HIV infection, are they more susceptible, even if they're not in full-blown, if they don't have full-blown AIDS, are they more susceptible to infections? Are they more susceptible to other health problems that knowing they had HIV might make them more aware of?
I think it matters on if they're treated, if their immune system is functioning, if they have a good, you know, what we call is the CD4 counts and would they be able to respond to infection? If they're not compliant with their medications and their levels go down, they become more susceptible. There are some, a lot of coexisting infectious disease with HIV positive patient population, especially people who may do IV drug use may have higher risk of hep C. People who have multiple sexual partners may have a higher risk of hep B. So sometimes the behaviors that led to an increased risk of HIV also can lead to an increased risk of some of the other infections that we try to treat.
So let's talk about the treatment. What does that mean for people in terms of if you have HIV infection, what is your treatment going to be like to prevent getting sicker?
Treatment has changed a lot over the last decade. When I was in fellowship, we used to have pills this many, like you had to carry like a big sachet of pills.
Oh no.
And which was very complicated and, you know, often and some of them required refrigeration. So now the pills are consolidated and they're consolidated even more now to like one tablet is a combination of three pills.
Hmm.
The minimum you have to be on at least three pills. So three pills are put together and formulated in one pill. So that is the recommendation now. There are guidelines, we look at the patients, we get screening labs, we map out their HIV virus and see exactly which medication is gonna work. So there's no guessing game. Mm-hmm. We know exactly which medication is gonna work before we start the patient on medication. We spend a lot of time looking at their lifestyle, looking at what the other health issues, and we work very closely with the primary care physician as well. So then we formulate a plan for them, and often it's one tablet once a day, which is very convenient, and most of the time people are doing great. Mm-hmm. I mean, they come back in 3 months and they're a whole new person. We see them more frequently initially, make sure everything is fine, and after that they're seen by us every 3 to 4 months. and most of the patients are doing very well.
Now, is this something that people will continue to do for the rest of their lives?
They have to be on medications for the rest of their lives.
Yes. But that's not so different from a lot of, whether it's high blood pressure, diabetes.
And the key is you're not going to have that opportunity for the rest of your life if you don't get diagnosed and put on the medication. So, you know, when someone presents very sick in the hospital with an advanced disease, that's kind of a failure of the public health, failure of primary care. There was one example of a patient who had been seen multiple times with different medical problems and was never offered an HIV test, and it was missed. I mean, this was someone who wasn't in that high-risk category, but was showing, you know, almost screaming out loud by being sick that, hey, it warrants an HIV test, never had an HIV test, ended up presenting late in her disease, and, you know, got on medication and hopefully got well, but she could have not gone through all that if she had had that HIV test just routinely recommended and prevented those illnesses from occurring.
Do you think there's a lot of talk about the heroin epidemic, which to me, I always think that involves to some degree IV drug use. Is that causing any kind of a spike in HIV infection? Is it possible to even tell at this point?
I think nationwide is still a big problem, mm-hmm. but in our population, it's not a big player. Most of our patients are not IV drug. We still have a lot of, you know, one third, but majority of them are heterosexual, and then MSM, men who have sex with men, and mm-hmm. then HIV because of IV drug abuse. And we have seen patients in 70s, you know, who are newly diagnosed. So there should be like no, I know the age cutoff is in 60s, but you should think of it at in any age group and get offered testing if possible.
So, well, if anyone is sexually active, they could be at risk.
Yeah.
Are condoms still the best protection?
Yes, they are recommended.
Prevention? Yep. The transmission with heterosexual couples in this day and age, are women at greater risk than men of acquiring it, or is it just even?
Women are a bit greater risk for acquiring, if the patient has tested positive, we do offer partner testing,
mm-hmm.
and then there are other measures you can take as well.
We have to remember, too, because we're within our own Berks County and our own country, but if you look globally, the epidemic of heterosexual transmission is huge. So, you know, it's not too far-fetched to think about what could happen here if people didn't use, you know, protection, didn't have, didn't get tested. We're doing well, but we can always do better. And there's evidence from around the world that this is not a gay disease. This is not, you know, there's not one category of people that put people at risk. They're pretty much everybody is at risk and should be tested.
Mm-hmm. Now, I've heard there's something called PrEP, is it, or PEP, where are there people who are at high risk who don't have the infection who can take measures to prevent it through medication?
Yeah, PEP is post-exposure prophylaxis.
Mm-hmm.
So someone who is, there are different types of PEP, like one is occupational exposure and one is non-occupational. So someone who works in healthcare, or even like someone who's outside and had an injury, somebody hit him, car accident, any kind of blood exposure, then they recommend to go to ER, and there are protocols in place how to treat those patients.
Mm-hmm.
So they're tested with HIV testing as well as other co-infections, and then they're treated. PrEP is a pre-exposure, so someone who has high risk behavior, lifestyle. They are offered medications to prevent HIV from acquiring HIV. It's very effective.
Is that something that can be offered through the primary care doctor?
It's not just offered, but we actually have some patients who take advantage of it. And insurance companies so far have paid for it. That was one of my questions. Will they pay for it? But they have. And with those patients, our primary care job is always to talk about behavior and behavior modification. And we try to discourage them from having the high-risk behavior, but there's some that are not yet ready to change that behavior, but will take the responsibility to take a medication to prevent the disease. So mm-hmm. We always use it in conjunction with trying to decrease the risky behavior, but those who are willing to take it, it can be very effective in preventing them from acquiring HIV. So it's another important tool in battling this.
Now, how long, if someone thinks they might have been exposed, is there a period of time where they have to wait before they're tested, or can the testing nowadays detect the virus right away?
Testing is very effective. It's very reliable. So it's over 99% reliable. There are obviously some people who will test negative. Mm-hmm. So if they have high risk, you know, and they acquired it, suppose the same day, it's possible they can be missed. So it's recommended to retest them. But the testing is a fourth generation testing. It's a very good test.
That's really encouraging. Yeah. So what would you tell people? What would be the big message you would want people to know about HIV infection from the infectious disease, from your point of view, taking care of patients?
I would advise patients to get tested, especially they know what their risk factors are. And if they have acquired HIV, they can contact us at Center of Public Health. The treatment is very different now. It's very patient-friendly, and a lot of other services provided as well.
Dr. Kelleher, primary care, what should people
primary
know?
Primary care, it's about getting people tested because, you know, we can't do anything about something that we don't know you have. Same thing with diabetes screening. Same thing with, you know, coming in and getting your blood pressure checked. So there are so many people walking around that have chronic diseases that don't know it. And when we have tools to make it better, the most important thing is come in and getting tested and just destigmatizing testing so that it becomes routine. You come in, you get your temperature taken, blood pressure taken, and go to lab and get your HIV test. And so taking away this stigma and just encouraging people to know their status can do a lot to prevent people from getting sicker down the road.
And I think at the same time too, I mean, it's important for people to know it is still very confidential. The testing is confidential, and those parts of your medical record are definitely kept at a more protected level, so it's not something that's advertised in your medical record. That information is protected, which is important, and it's a way to let you protect your family. Mm-hmm. If you don't know your status, you could be making your family ill without realizing it.
And Berks County does have some resources to help people notify their partners if they were positive, because that could be a very difficult conversation to have. So a lot of times they can help people outreach to partners and to family members and let them know that they should be tested if they're at risk. So it's not something that if you do find out your status and you're afraid to discuss it, there are resources to help you allow other people to get tested so that, you know, and that can be done confidential and you can help people stay healthy.
So you don't have to say so-and-so was tested positive.
No.
These resources can just go to people who might have been your partners.
Right.
That's really encouraging. Well, as we said at the beginning of the show, if you're watching us on January 6th until 3:30 this afternoon at Berks Community Health Center on Penn Street, there is free rapid HIV testing. It takes maybe half an hour, 45 minutes. So we would encourage anyone who wants to stop in to Berks Community Health Center today to do that. I think we'll be doing more of these events, hopefully in the future. And you can always, whether at our primary care office or at your primary care physician, you can ask for HIV testing. There doesn't
and
have
I think
to be
the Center for Public Health has
and
a walk-in.
And the Center for Public Health. You have a walk-in.
Yeah, we have walk-in, and we also have other services for HIV patients, mental health service, nutrition service, pharmacy program, and a lot of social worker on staff. So
that is great.
Really good support system.
Lots
that
of good services
great.
There.
Awesome. So check in with the Center for Public Health with your primary care doctor. Thank you for being with us today, and we will see you again next month on Berks Community Health Center Presents.